there. My name is Eugene Colvin. I suppose y'all are here to learn about the story of Frederick Douglass. That farm over there belonged to my great uncle, a certain Master Colvin. He was one of Douglass's many masters. But before we start on that story, you should probably get some background information about Douglass first. Douglass was born in the not-so-great state of Maryland to his mother, Harriet Bailey. No one knew who his father was, although rumor had it that his master, Captain Anthony, was his father. Almost at the moment of his birth, he was removed from his mother and sent to live with his Nima. Under her loving care and protection, he learned many great things, such as the songs of his fellow slaves, a testimony to the atrocities and oppression hailed on them by their masters. He also learned to fear the whip. It was at a young age that Douglass witnessed the atrocity of his aunt, Hester, whipped within an inch of her life for a crime she was said to have committed. It was events like that that increased Douglass's fear of his master. And as he approached the age where work would be expected from him, his fear only grew. But between the age of 7 and 8, something happened. Something that Douglass would later come out to say was a blessing in disguise. His master, Captain Anthony, had decided that he was of better use to one of his relatives, a certain Master Auld. And it is at this point in Douglass's great life that we join him on his journey, where he is just coming up the street to meet his new master. His new master, Mr. Auld.
Oh, it's here, it's here, coming, coming. Oh, Hugh, I told you it would come.
Yes, yes, nothing but the very best for you, dear.
Oh, come in, come in! Oh, this is so exciting!
Does it come with instructions?
Oh, don't be silly, dear. Ask him yourself.
Hello! Do you come with a manual?
What's a manual?
Oh, I can talk. Oh, I have to pee so bad.
Woman, you always have to pee.
Are we talking about Mother's bowel movements again?
No, we're not. Never again.
Tommy, why don't you take your new plaything up to your room and show him how you want it cleaned?
Do I have to? Oh, this is so exciting. I'm gonna teach you how to clean, how to cook, how to do laundry, how to fix mid-morning tea, how to read, how to...
No! Not how to read.
Why even that?
A slave that can read is no longer fit to be a slave. He'll never be content with his life, and is despoiled from his purpose.
And from that moment on, Frederick knew that he had to learn how to read. If it was something his master feared, it would be something that he would conquer.
us fight just to keep them alive. It's me, I am the tiger. It's the thrill of the fight, rising up to the challenge of our rival. And the last known survivor stalks his prey in the night, and he's watching us now with the eye of the tiger.
Over the years, owning a slave changed Mrs. Auld for the worse. And it was at this precise moment that Douglas's life changed for the worse.
Get the door!
Your master, Captain Anthony, is dead. You've been summoned to assess your worth.
And so, Douglas returned to his old home, only to be returned to Mr. Auld. Then to be shipped to one Master Covey, a man famous for breaking slaves.
Welcome to the farm. It's a hand, son. You shake it.
What was that for?
You're a slave. I'm a slave breaker. Get used to it. Come here.
As he spent his time on the farm, he soon realized why his fellow slaves referred to my uncle, Master Covey, as the snake.
Boo! Boo! Pick that up! Get back to work!
Eventually, Douglas realized he couldn't take it much longer, and he fought back.
I got you good that time, Mark! Looks like we got a fighter.
Come on.
Some say that after the fight, Covey learned to fear Douglas. I like to believe that he learned to respect him. But either way, Covey never whipped Douglas again. But his time with him soon came to an end. Bye-bye. You come back soon, hear?
I sure taught him a lesson.
Frederick was sent back to Master Hugh, where he learned to be a caulker and would work all day only to return to give his wages to his master.
Yes, yes, come in.
Here you go, Master Hugh.
This is it? This is less than you gave me last week.
I'm sorry, sir, but work is getting scarcer for me. You see, people don't like paying a slave for stuff that their slaves can do for themselves.
You break my heart, Douglas. You break my heart. Tell you what I'm going to do. Would you shut up?
Grazie. Tell you what I'm going to do. Take some. Now go on, take it.
Thank you.
You work hard, take the afternoon off. But I want you back at 5 tomorrow. Got that?
But little did Don Hugh know, Frederick wouldn't return to work at 5. In a brilliant and risky move, Douglas ran for the north with his fiancée, that no one even knew he had until this point in the story, and became a free man.
Free at last.
He adopted a new life with his wife, and with the encouragement of some friends, discovered his talent with public speaking at an abolitionist's convention, where he helps fire the movement for the rest of his life. The end.
Yeah.